I'm Lauren Griessmeyer. I'm the practice director for Orders, Beaker, and Willow at Nordic. I'm here today with Aaron Herzog.
Hello.
Aaron is one of our resident Beaker experts. I'm going to have you give a little bit of a background on yourself.
Sure.
So tell us about Aaron.
As Lauren said, I'm Aaron Herzog. I'm a senior Beaker consultant with Nordic. I've been in the Beaker world since 2009. I was at Epic there when Beaker was just a young application. I think there were two customers live at the time. Seen it grow, develop, add some new modules, and really excited to talk about it today.
Cool. So one of the kind of main things that I think a lot of customers, kind of main questions that a lot of customers have, mm-hmm. especially since Beaker is a newer application, is what does Beaker get you?
Sure.
Why should
sure.
you convert from another LIS to Beaker?
Sure. I think where most customers see an advantage with Beaker is the integration points. Like at this point, most meaningful use meeting LISs, if that makes sense, or LISs that are meeting meaningful use, have the same basic functionality. What you get with Beaker is integration points such as, you know, billing works a little better mm-hmm. since you're dropping the charges directly into an Epic billing application. You have additional features such as the ability in the latest release to for a doctor to see what specimens are available in the lab.
Okay.
So instead of sticking a patient again for another draw, they're just like, I need this test. I see we have a specimen in the lab. Let's add it on.
So this is pre-results hitting the patient's chart.
Yeah, it's just a specimen being in the lab from a previous draw.
Okay.
Instead of sticking the patient again, you just add it on. Saves the patient a little bit of pain. Really popular in like pediatric settings where you
yeah.
want to, you know, stick the patient as few times as possible. Some other customers have even went as far to do like a regless lab draw scenario where you basically just have the kiosk, it schedules the patient, you don't even need a registrar there, so you can save a little bit of time and money that way too.
Okay. So one of the things that you just mentioned as you're kind of answering that question is how integrated Beaker is mm-hmm. with the rest of your system if you have Epic. Can you talk a little bit about the integration that Beaker has with some of the other teams, such as your billing team or your procedure order teams?
Sure.
And some of the tricky points that you may run into while doing an install, since it's not an LIS, it's in isolation.
Yep. So, you know, typically third-party LISs sort of live on their own island. You know, they send charges via an interface mm-hmm. for in the billing scenario back into Epic, but that's really, you know, the end of the LISs part of the billing workflow.
Sure.
For Beaker, you are much more integrated. You have control of sort of when you're dropping charges, how you're dropping the charges. For example, okay. in Beaker, you can choose to drop a charge when you receive a specimen as opposed to when the specimen is verified.
And what kind of a workflow would that be an advantage for?
It's for micro, like
okay.
tests that take, you know, maybe
a couple weeks
exactly.
and you have to retest the sample.
Exactly. Okay. So you can get that billing done right up front instead of having to create, you know, maybe a second claim or, you know, whatever. I'm not a billing expert. So whatever other billing comes downstream after the specimen has been verified.
Okay.
I'd say, in general, a lot of your workflows do change. Billing, registration, results routing all change with
mm-hmm.
Beaker. And they're sort of tricky because when you have a third-party LIS, those applications really do own the pieces in Epic, where Beaker has a lot more sort of collaborative build and configuration you need to do. So for a brand new install where Beaker is going live for the first time, you know, it's not really that different because the customer is converting
right.
to Epic as a whole.
So you're talking about an enterprise
yes.
where Beaker is part of the enterprise
yeah.
install.
Versus an add-on where a customer is adding on Beaker and the other Epic applications have been live for a while, those workflows tend to require some additional tweaking from those applications.
Okay. How prepared do you think a lot of customers are for doing that additional work?
I think it surprises a lot of customers.
Okay.
They expect that, you know, Epic has one workflow regardless
yeah.
of the application mix, and that's just not the case at all times.
Okay. One of the things that you just said is that, you know, Beaker is integrated with Epic, and that third-party LISs, you know, they're typically talking by an interface. Mm-hmm. So does that mean that Beaker has no interfaces? Is it a plug and play system?
So
that smile, I think, probably tells me my answer.
It does. It's not plug and play. Beaker does have interfaces. You're not interfacing directly to another EMR, from an LIS to an mm-hmm. EMR, but you have interfaces to your instruments. You often have interfaces to blood bank, and you'll also have like results in and out interfaces, depending okay. on whether your customer is or whether the client is doing reference lab work for other laboratories.
Okay.
So you end up with a number of interfaces that can get quite challenging depending on sort of the scope of the interface.
When staffing teams, do you typically see somebody that gets dedicated to just the interfaces?
Sure.
Or should that be a recommendation that maybe doesn't always
It is.
Happen,
you or? Should have an interface expert, but where I've seen that customers can get themselves in trouble is if you have an expert who really knows everything and you don't do a good job of cross-training, you end up in a go-live scenario where you only have 12 hours of coverage, and then the other 12 hours, you know, where you have 24-hour support the first week or two, no one knows what to do with the interfaces.
So when you only have one person,
yes.
it's kind of a... You kind of have to almost clone that person during
yeah.
the go-live.
So it's definitely important to have your experts, but make sure there's people who can also speak to the workflows and troubleshoot
gotcha.
As well.
So... with your kind of broad knowledge of how many customers, you know, you've been on. So first, let's kind of back up. We kind of left that piece out
sure.
of your introduction.
Yep.
So how many customers have you been involved in for full installs, and how many have you done some advisory work with?
For full installs, I've been on 4, and I've done advisory work for another 4.
That's always a fun question to ask,
4 to 6,
right?
Yeah, while I was doing implementation at Epic, I also did some QA work.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a lot of like specific, special updates or other little fixes that I tested for specific customers.
Sure.
So that advisory role question kind of gets tricky.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's part of the reason I asked it, because I know that Beaker tends to be kind of a special child. When you talk to people that are at Epic, that team tends to work a little bit differently
mm-hmm.
than a lot of the other application teams. So it seems like the backgrounds of people tend to be more mixed. I've
mm-hmm.
noticed that, you know, you just use the example of being an implementation person that had a QA background. I've noticed that, you know, you have people that have a QA background that actually end up doing a lot of customer work.
Yep.
And that's not necessarily the case with all the other applications. So... does that kind of mix of multiple jobs kind of produce more well-rounded people, or do you guys still get to kind of specialize so that when you're, you know, playing
yep.
to, you know, out and looking for a new gig or, you know, a new sort of customer, do you have certain strengths that you want to play towards?
Oddly enough, it's sort of both. I think you definitely, you know, anyone specializes in certain aspects of any knowledge base. Like, I'm really passionate about interfaces and billing, for example, but having done a little bit of quality assurance work, I have a better grasp of when something needs a fix,
mm-hmm.
sort of how long it takes, how reasonable it is if, you know, let's say my customer is a couple versions behind,
sure.
how long that fix is going to take for Epic to do,
sure.
considering they need to do it through a couple versions before it gets back to them.
It probably helps too with testing some of the workflows.
Yeah,
like
definitely.
I've heard that testing for, we talked about micro before, testing for micro workflows can be pretty in depth, I've heard, and pretty hairy because of the long-term nature of some
yep.
of the tests.
Yeah, it definitely gives you a different mindset when testing, because you're sort of looking at, how can I break this versus does it actually work?
Yeah.
And that is definitely an advantage to find those before you're live.
Yeah,
yeah.
For sure.